So when man reaches this level of self-identity and looking at himself and saying, here I am, we go through three stages, which is my next phase, number three. First, we have to learn to love and care for ourselves. In my love model, that's the sex and violence love stage, because all of a sudden you find yourself in a tiny little body and you have to learn how to deal with the laws of gravity. You've got to learn that fire is hot and can burn you, things are sharp and can cut you, you can fall, you can really get hurt. So first thing we got to do as an infant and a child is learn how to deal with the laws of physics and recognize what we got to learn to not destroy ourselves and what we have to do to take care of ourselves. The kid's got to learn to wipe its bottom, it's got to learn to drink water, eat food. So this is the stage of I. So I create myself, because we can't stay at home forever and have mommy feeding us and wiping our butts, and we have to learn how to deal with the responsibility of loving and caring for our body. And unfortunately, we're not doing much better at caring for our bodies than we are for our planet, largely due to a lot of belief in science that is destroying the planet and you, right? Science that isn't even science anymore. It's outdated and old. Then we have to deal with the we level of creation. I call that conditional love, because anytime you're in a relationship with someone, eventually you come to the realization you have to establish conditions by which you feel safe to give and receive love. That's what a relationship's about. That's what a contract and a business is about. That's what a rental agreement is. The rental car agreement says, we'll love you by loaning our car to you if you will love us by not destroying our car. Here's the terms. We're giving it to you with a full tank of gas. We want you to bring it back with a full tank of gas, or we're going to charge you for it. So we find that love and relationships needs to happen through conditional love. I can love you when this happens and this happens, but not if this happens. If you abuse me, I can't love you. If you disrespect me, I'm not willing to stay engaged in that kind of a relationship. So sex and violence love, learning to take care of yourself, emerges as learning to understand that each of us is a unique expression of love, and like gears, not all of them fit together. So you have to, a door has to fit into the frame. A Phillips screwdriver does not work well on a standard screw head. It's not the right fit. So the conditions to use a standard screwdriver is you have a standard screw just in order to make that relationship work. And we all have to learn at the we stage how to have values. What is my dream? How will I manage my diet, my quiet, and my movement? What kind of spiritual life do I need? How much time do I need to myself? What kind of people will nurture my own growth and development and therefore be supportive of me? Those are all values. Those are the conditions by which you choose your tribe, your church, your spiritual group, your community, your culture. And that's even what nationalism is. Nationalism is just a country as an organism having a relationship with another country as an organism, and look how much trouble we have with that level. Then we go to the all level, which comes when we reach the stage of empathetic and compassionate love. Empathy means to feel the other, compassion means to understand the other. But now we're understanding the other by understanding ourselves. You see, oh yes, I used to be a sex and violence lover and did all sorts of things. And I was way past the point at which I should have mastered understanding conditional love. I was acting like an idiot all the way up into my 20s, drinking, smoking, crashing, being disrespectful, blah, blah, blah. Acting like a child, not unusual. But once we get up to this level, we look at the world. And we see the silliness and we say, oh, look at that young man. He got caught driving drunk for the third time. Oh, instead of saying, lock the son of a bitch up, kill him, he killed the girl in the car, give him the death penalty, we say, how unfortunate and how sad. I remember I used to do that too. I just got lucky and didn't kill anybody like him. Let's hope that he wakes up. Maybe he has time to find himself in jail. Maybe there will be a good teacher in there. So instead of eye for an eye, it becomes I see myself. And that's what empathy and compassion is. And that was the function of the elders in all tribal societies, is to raise the children from the perspective of empathy and compassion, not from the perspective of a rental contract, because that turns a child into an object and they lose their sense of connection, because there is no connection. It's either you did it right or you did it wrong. You're either going to pay for the broken, damaged fender or you're not. And if you're not, I'm going to take you to court. You're going to go to jail. It's that simple. So we need people that have empathy and compassion, because they can honestly reflect on their own life path and see all of that and look around at their lives. And then when you get to the level of empathy and compassion, you have empathy and compassion for nature. You have empathy and compassion for human beings. You can even have empathy and compassion for God. You can say, my goodness, look at what God goes through to wake up to what God really is. It's mind-boggling. Look at all the pain and all the challenges. So empathy and compassion, interestingly, opens your vision up. Because as you relax in the world and see that there's beauty behind it, your heart opens. And then you start feeling without having to think. And you start thinking with feeling. Thinking and feeling are absolutely necessary components of each other, or you're always half informed at best. Imagine if you were a judge in a court of law that had no sense of feeling. You'd be no different than a psychopath. You'd make distinctions based on what is written, not what is real. Okay? So that basically brings us into this most amazing symphony that the Tai Chi symbol depicts. That which is in the womb is given birth to and embodied. Once the infant is born and begins to breathe, the yang cycle begins. So the seed that starts over here, the seed or the sperm, comes down into the material seed, the idea of the tree or the plant or the rabbit or the squirrel is embodied. So you could call those archetypal expressions of consciousness manifesting itself in form through embodiment, that it emerges, it grows, it becomes, it has its own life cycle. We go through these stages of consciousness, but interestingly, we can't make it through any of these stages of consciousness without protecting the earth and the microorganisms and the plants and the animals, because they're what give us life. They're what give us food. They're what give us air. The water is purified and made drinkable by all the organisms and the grand symphony of amazing cooperation that we are so beautifully destroying out of our own intelligence manifesting as stupidity. We're you know, how smart is a race when they're destroying the very fabric that gives them existence, right? I mean, how many people piss in their own water before they drink it? Most people wouldn't do that, yet they'll poison everything. They'll take drugs that have a list of side effects far worse than the problem they're after. So we have to kind of wake up to the fact that the middle world is where consciousness embodies itself, but it needs to be maintained just like your own body does. Otherwise, this starts to degenerate, and the whole process of self-realization or of the ability to exchange love, shall we say, gets crippled as it is becoming. So, creativity in love is reality. What is reality? It's what's happening right now. What is love? The flow of energy and information through empathic and compassionate connection to self or other, or consciousness becoming aware of itself. And you would probably agree that human beings are probably more aware of themselves than a lot of animals, a lot of plants or microorganisms or atoms in and of themselves. And otherwise, you know, you don't see atoms collecting themselves into conscious forms. Something has to do that. We are part of something that is indescribably beautiful and large. So my closing message is, if you're in the middle, you have the most amazing opportunity to actually look out and see what eternity looks like as it manifests itself as place. Your body is a place. It's your private place. It's your temple of worship. You have the magical experience of being able to hug and kiss people that you love and be hugged and kissed by people that love you, and to share and to learn and to grow. And this is the realm of creativity. So you could say this is where consciousness chooses its palette of paint and color and paints it on the canvas in the middle that we call life. And my desire is to share that if we were a little bit more amazed at the opportunity we have to be alive and the opportunity we have to share with each other, that we would be a lot more likely to love and respect each other and care for the planet and know that there's a lot of souls that deserve that chance too. And what is a soul but consciousness manifesting in as self-awareness? An eye cannot see itself, so metaphorically, God can't know God without a subject-object relationship, and this is how it's created. And if we didn't have a subject-object relationship, paradoxically, love would have nowhere to go. There would be no flow, and therefore the whole thing becomes phased screen to black and meaningless. So, that's my, shall we say, less shamanic explanation of the three worlds. I hope you feel inspired to join me each day in celebrating the magical mystery of being in the middle of love and knowing that whatever you want to do is God doing you, consciousness doing you. I'm not talking about an old man in the sky. I'm saying that which is unknowable but is obviously real because we're here. And some resources, PPS Success Mastery Lesson 10, Exploring the Great Polarities. My Four Doctor audio companions go into some of the metaphysical concepts beyond what my multimedia ebook, The Last Four Doctors You'll Ever Need, covers. PPS Success Mastery coaching calls. I answer questions about things like this regularly. There's about 6 years of weekly coaching calls. Once you're in the program, you can listen to all those calls and you will have hundreds of discussions like this. Holistic Lifestyle Coach Training is where I teach you how to use concepts like these to go beyond just an understanding, but how do we put this into practice in your life? How do we enhance your likelihood of freedom in your life, having a body that works for you, being able to create your dreams without constantly being chained to pills and doctors and all that kind of stuff? So thanks for joining me today. Look forward to sharing it with you soon. I'm Paul Chek.